Well, thank you, Hugh. I'm really pleased to have this opportunity. And I was just so taken with the concept of Tundi and the bringing of Wagner performance to a place like Brattleboro in this way that I was really, really glad to participate in this way. And for today, I took this as an opportunity to put together some thoughts about two aspects of the Ring cycle that I find meaningful, in some ways vexing, and also just fascinating. One of them revolves around a set of human meanings that are dramatized in the Ring cycle that I feel are relevant to us today. And also the ways in which the way in which we experience these as an audience are shaped by the music and the performance in which they are, through which they are presented. So my hope today is that in some way, some of my observations may help the audience and performers perhaps, I guess, appreciate and understand aspects of these operas as we hear them. And in both Das Rheingold and Die Walküre, indeed throughout the Ring cycle, the drama is driven by characters acting upon their own personal desires, at times selfishly and occasionally heroically. These desires inevitably crash into points of resistance, impediments, disagreements, and barriers. The actions, reactions, and conflicts that arise are the mainspring of the often tragic actions we witness on stage, and ultimately provide much of the meaning of these works. In the process, we are forced to confront the limits of freedom and its relationship to responsibility, and often social responsibility. The situations occur throughout the work, involving many different characters, and here are just a few of them, which I'm sure are familiar to many of you. The first of them arises right at the start of the first scene of Das Rheingold. We watch Alberich, the king of the Nibelungs, deep in the Rhine River, as he encounters a trio of Rhine maidens cavorting in the waters. He's attracted by them. He lusts after them and awkwardly and lecherously tries to grab them. They, in turn, escape him, tease him, and mock him. Suddenly, this uncomfortable scene is disrupted as the sun breaks out and a sunbeam illuminates the gold at the bottom of the river. The Rhine maidens rejoice at the sight of the gold. Alberich, too, is lured by the gold, and the maidens tell him that they guard this Rhine gold. And then they tell him more. The gold has magical power that will allow anyone who renounces love and erotic pleasure and who can forge the ring, a ring out of the gold, will gain tremendous power. Power over others and ultimately power of control and great wealth. What the maidens do not foresee is that Alberich, frustrated in his clumsy, lustful forays toward them, suddenly shifts his desire to a lust for power. He grabs the gold, dramatically renounces love, and scurries off to have it forged into a magic ring, the magic ring that he now hopes and believes he will be able to use to enslave the other Nibelungen. In the second scene of the opera, it is Wotan, the chief god, whose intemperate desire sets the wheels of conflict in motion. He long dreamed of a truly splendid new palace, and now he has made an agreement and signed a contract with two giants, the brothers Fafner and Fasolt, to construct it. And when we first come upon the scene, the giants, as agreed, have in fact built him his beautiful new palace, Valhalla, and it is a magnificent achievement. In exchange, as a form of payment, Wotan has agreed with them that they shall receive his sister-in-law, Freya. Wotan's wife, Fricka, and Freya's other siblings are, of course, outraged and horrified by this and demand an immediate halt to this plan. In his efforts to resolve the situation, Eventually, Wotan tracks down Alberich in his subterranean realm, where he has, in fact, forged this ring. I won't spoil the story for you by explaining how it all happens, but Wotan finally succeeds in getting the ring from Alberich, along with a great store of gold. And as Alberich is forced to surrender the ring, he curses it, declaring death and misery upon anyone who shall possess it until it is returned to him. Wotan's plan is to use the gold to pay off the giants, and he wants to keep the ring. As Sophie was just describing to us, he has become enamored by a desire to possess the ring and the power that it would bring him. But again, as it transpires, he too must surrender the ring and the gold in order to secure Freya's return. As soon as the giants have the ring, they begin to fight. Fasolt would have much preferred the beloved Freya, but his brother Fafnir is more enamored of gold and power. And then Fafnir abruptly kills Fasolt in anger, as if as the first fulfillment of this curse of the ring. And he retreats to his dwelling place, where the ring remains until the middle of the third opera of the cycle. So here, in just one opera, three situations in which the grasping at desire is fulfilled, if briefly, yet brings with it terrible consequences. The tragic course of the next opera, Die Walküre, is set in motion by the passionate yet seemingly authentic and forbidden love of Siegmund and Sieglinde. The stories we now witness hinge primarily on desire that is frustrated. Siegmund and Sieglinde wish to be together in love, and Wotan, sympathetic to their passion, is prepared to enable this. His wife, Fricka, the guardian goddess of wedlock, compels him to submit to the law of marriage rather than to follow his personal desires. And here we begin to see this interplay between the laws and treaties and rules of social convention coming into conflict with desire, which is, I think, probably most dramatically represented through the plights that Wotan finds himself in. But Fricka opposes the union of Siegmund and Sieglinde. Not only are they committing adultery, Sieglinde is already married to someone else, but also incest, for they are brother and sister. Wotan grudgingly agrees to submit to these laws, and he orders Brunhilde, his favorite daughter, and the Valkyrie, who is the namesake of this opera, to inform Siegmund that he is destined to fall dead in his duel with Hunding. But when she confronts Siegmund, Brunhilde is won over by his heroic declaration that he would rather die definitively than live in paradise without his beloved Sieglinde. Brunhilde is so moved that she resolves to intervene in the duel so that Siegmund may survive. But in the event, Wotan contravenes Brunhilde's decision and does what he thinks he must. He steps in to allow Hunding's victory, and with Siegmund dead, he kills Hunding himself in a state of torment and ire. A very chilling moment in the opera, I find. So in both of these operas, we are led through a steady stream of highly charged scenes in which desire collides with opposing forces. The emotion and psychology of each situation, and often each character, is enacted on stage by the performers and brought to life through the music and singing. Wagner sought to create what he once called deeds of music made visible. And much of Wagner's great skill as a composer was his ability to create musical deeds that support and characterize the dramatic and emotional deeds that unfold on stage. It's this coordinated artistic experience that compels us as listeners and engages us as viewers. And I think it is really, every time I turn to Wagner's music, and I'm hardly a great Wagnerite, but the extraordinary fusion of musical expression and dramatic event is really quite extraordinary. Wagner, as you know, theorized extensively about what he was doing, was going to do, and what he had done. And often his writings are not nearly as masterful as his musical composition. But they can be quite fascinating in their own right. And Wagner described his goal in his dramatic stage works as emotionalizing the intellect. This is a very fascinating and loaded term, I think. The idea of creating, as Wagner put it, a complete communication between the intellect and our feelings by using all available means of artistic expression to act directly upon our senses. Because, as Wagner said, our senses are our most immediate organs for the conception of feeling. And it's worth noting here that Wagner is thinking very much of the synthesis of the arts that he's bringing together, drama and music and acting and staging and, of course, singing. And it was only in this way, Wagner believed, that he could emotionalize the intellect, a process by which we come, as he said, to know through feeling as much or more than we know by merely rational means. And I think a moment of reflection makes it clear that using feelings and emotions to shape rational understanding is a problematic as well as powerful matter. Friedrich Nietzsche, who was one of the probably the greatest of the Wagner apostates, he started as a great admirer and champion of Wagner and turned into perhaps Wagner's most pointed and in some ways most insightful critic. And Nietzsche said famously that Wagner, strumming my lute. That's leftover from Sophie's talk, I guess. Nietzsche said that Wagner was a musical magician who was able to enchant us even against our better judgment and against our disbelief. And there is little doubt that Wagner's musical settings and their presentation by singers and musicians can be powerfully affecting. They provide a powerful emotional scenario that draws each audience member in as it shapes how the situations unfold and inflects how we understand what's happening. So I'd like to focus for a few minutes on how music works in this way in two scenes in particular, namely the opening of each of the two operas we will witness this weekend. The opening of Das Rheingold is a scene of primal immediacy. In the depths of the Rhine River, which is itself a symbol of primordial nature, we watch and listen with a sort of horrible fascination as Alberic grasps after the three Rhine maidens. So here is music example one. Are they loud? Was that loud enough? One of the key rules of I've learned as a teacher is play the music examples loud. And in this music, there is a kind of crude honesty in the depiction of Alberich. His desire is base, uncivilized, unsocial, purely egotistic. And I think we can hear that in the music in Wagner's setting. The examples I'm playing for you are from the recordings of the Ring Cycle by the Dresden Staatskapelle conducted by Marek Janowski, with the main singers are Sigmund Nimsgern, Siegfried Jerusalem, and Jesse Norman. And following the unfolding drama, the music, a sudden change occurs musically as well as dramatically when the sun lights up the gold and it's vividly realized. You can follow the turn of events quite distinctly in the music. So here's music example number two, Peter. Wagner is using all of the tools of romantic musical characterization. The sudden change to a major key, the shimmering string tremolos, the brilliant motif in the trumpets, even little quiet little splashes from the cymbals. And I think you can almost visualize the effect through the music in some way. And equally emotionally direct is Alberich's acceptance of the fateful bargain he makes, the promise of great power in exchange for the renunciation of the ring. And again, as we'll hear in music example three, this is brought to life through music very directly. So in this scene, and above all in its music, at least for me, the dramatic and emotional valence of the situation is very clearly depicted and presented through the music. And we can hear Alberich making a very heartless bargain, being seduced not by love or even sexual desire at the end of the scene, but rather by a lust for power. The opening of Die Walküre sounds and feels very different from this, and yet I think it harbors some covert parallels as well as mirror images of what we have just heard. Here, the curtain rises to reveal a man fleeing a storm through the night. He stumbles upon a home in the forest and is admitted hesitantly by the woman alone inside. As he drinks the water that she gives him to quench his thirst, a glance between the two is exchanged, and an immediate attraction begins to glow through the music initially. And the music that Wagner uses here is wordless and is of extraordinary innocence and disarming tenderness. So this is example 4. And one of the things that I think is often overlooked, perhaps, or is maybe not immediately obvious, is the way in which the music controls the pace of events. And at times, and this is infamous in Wagner, the pace is quite leisurely. but at other moments, things happen in a very, very hectic way. But the control of the emotional pacing is, a very important aspect of the musical setting. And here, this is clearly a long, prolonged, highly significant mutual gaze between the two soon-to-be lovers. And as the scene unfolds, the situation becomes clear to us. Sieglinde is a young woman trapped in a forced, loveless marriage. Sigmund is a young man wandering lost after the murder of his family, relentlessly seeking to escape his woe, as he says. But soon, Sieglinde's husband, Hunding, returns. He's a fierce man, and he senses what is developing between Sigmund and his wife, and he doesn't like it. Although the laws of hospitality demand that he shelter Sigmund that night, at dawn, he declares, they will fight a duel of honor to the death. So later, left alone in dark solitude, Sigmund is bereft. He's alone, he's without any weapon, and he sees that he is surely doomed. He calls upon his ancestors to help him. And in an odd mirroring of what we heard in Das Rheingold, a beam of light, this time from the sparks of the fire dying in the fireplace, a beam of light illuminates a glint of metal. Sigmund sees something, but he doesn't grasp what it is initially. As he gazes, he wonders if that could be a reflection of Sieglinde's lovely glance. In fact, what he sees is a sword, but he does not realize it yet. But perhaps in Wagner's terms, he feels it before he actually understands what it actually is. And again, I think this is another scene in which the music very clearly acts out what is happening internally in some sense. So this is music example number 5.
Strahl bricht aus der Pesche Scham.
And I think there are some interesting musical parallels with what we heard in Das Rheingold as well. But again, you can hear the similar sort of musical technique, the glimmering strings, the sword motif played by the trumpet. But as I said, Sigmund senses it, but he doesn't grasp quite the reality of the situation. But soon, as the fire dies out, Sieglinde appears in the darkness. She's put Hunding to sleep with a sleeping potion, and she tells Sigmund about the sword that is embedded in the trunk of the tree by the fireplace of their home. Right? This is a very sort of rustic Norse woods kind of home with a tree in the house where there is a sword embedded. And it was put there by a disguised Wotan, her father, on the terrible day of her wedding. And at the time, he declared cryptically that only a true hero would be able to pull it free from its fixed location. It's another parallel with Das Rheingold, in which it is a woman who has to explain things to the man who doesn't quite understand them. As the situation dawns on Sigmund and Sieglinde, many things do become clear to them. For one thing, it is obvious to them that Sigmund must be the hero for whom the sword is destined. In fact, as the act drives to its conclusion, Sigmund does withdraw the sword as the music surges. And in some performances, Sieglinde lets out a spontaneous scream of pleasure and astonishment at this moment. And then, moments later, the curtain falls as the couple embrace passionately. So this is music example number 6. And this is compelling and thrilling music. It sweeps us along and surely wins our sympathy. Wagner's music clearly does have a power to compel its listeners to feel with it and to be gripped by it very movingly and directly. This is a skill that I think was unequaled before Wagner's time and has been matched only rarely since then. But alongside the sympathetic response engendered by the music and the scene we've witnessed, we are left to reckon intellectually as well as emotionally with the uncomfortable fact that Sigmund and Sieglinde are long-lost brother and sister, twins no less, born of an illicit rendezvous between Wotan and a mortal woman. As the act reaches its climax, they openly acknowledge this fact, recognizing that it is transgressive, however, does nothing to cool their ardor. In fact, in some sense, it seems to intensify it. And in some way, the power and perhaps paradoxically the purity of their love is confirmed by this fact, that in some ways it could not be constrained even by the strongest of social rules, of taboos. The audience, too, is confronted by this realization. I can recall the conflicting emotions I felt the first time I attended a performance of this opera in the theater, as this scene played out and reached its triumphant peak. And then afterwards, during the intermission, which follows immediately, being left with the questions it poses. The scene plays on conflicting impulses, the purity of love and passion versus the value of righteous convention, of freedom versus social responsibility. Because in a certain sense, all of these rules, these treaties that Sophie described, for example, are ultimately social. We need these things in order to be able to live together in a more or less harmonious relation with our neighbors, friends, colleagues, and others. Indeed, one way in understanding the remaining two acts of this opera, and maybe the Ring cycle as a whole, is as the dramatic, ultimately tragic playing out of the tensions that emerge from this conflict between passion, the rules of social convention, which closely tracks, in a certain way, Wagner's duality of emotion and reason. Ambivalences are created within the listener, the viewer, inevitably, and ambivalence is, I believe, an essential aspect of the Wagnerian experience. He deployed the powerful expressive vocabulary of the Romantic music tradition, the compelling rhetoric of musical personification, to impress emotions and attitudes upon the audience, and indeed to actually arouse emotions and attitudes within the viewer. In this way, Wagner's dramatic musical synthesis can and often does act over and above, and at times directly against, one's better judgment and one's rational common sense. For this reason, some have sensed something dangerous in music, and perhaps in Wagner's music above all, in its sensual power and emotional force to shape and infuse rational judgment. Thomas Mann, the great German novelist and essayist, declared, quote, "A passion for Wagner's enchanted works has been a driving passion of his, and his goal to invest this music with understanding was one of the driving forces of his life." Mann was one of the very greatest writers on Wagner precisely because he was one of the most ambivalent, keenly aware of the greatness of Wagner's works and equally of their weaknesses and perhaps even their dangers. And it's significant, I think, that the statement I just quoted was one that he made at the very beginning of the Nazi dictatorship in Germany. And it was a conundrum, a moral dilemma that concerned him and even obsessed him increasingly over the final 15 years of his life. In his great novel, The Magic Mountain, he had one of his characters, Ludovico Settembrini, give voice to one of Mann's concerns in this regard. Settembrini is a depiction of an arch-rationalist who believes in the power of reason above all. And at one point in the novel, he says, "Music can have the effect of an opiate on one's reason, a devilish effect, because it creates stupor, inertia, inactivity, servile stagnation. There is something questionable about music, gentlemen. I maintain that it is of an ambiguous nature. I do not go too far in declaring it politically suspect." And these concerns that Settembrini voiced were clearly ones that Mann, to some extent, shared, and ones that certainly he applied to Wagner. Wagner's music can be intoxicating, even hypnotizing. In the scene with Sigmund and Sieglinde, for example, the gripping music may, and I think often does, have the power to override, at least momentarily, our deeply ingrained revulsion at incest. In watching this scene, it is difficult not In witnessing this scene, maybe is a better verb, it's difficult not to feel sympathetic to the two young lovers. And the ability for this paradoxical emotional situation to exist in us, I think, is both fascinating, in some ways, I think, very enjoyable, but also perhaps worthy of a degree of suspicion upon reflection. Throughout these operas, the aesthetic power of performance of music and acting and singing threatens to inflect, or is it infect, our sensibilities. And throughout these operas, we are confronted by highly charged scenes that involve conflicts between strong desires. One well-established way of understanding the basic tensions that animate the Ring Cycle dramas is that they derive from the conflict, which is ultimately irreconcilable, between traditional forms of, and here I'm quoting an author named Rather, he said, between frozen, dead, and corrupt morality versus the spontaneous living morality of the fully aware, free human individual. And I think to a great extent, Wagner shared this view, this idea of this kind of heroic freedom of the enlightened, empowered individual. But this opposition can be overdrawn, but it's not baseless. It does apply, for example, to Sigmund, who is entirely given to his pure desire for a love that is judged illicit, even unnatural, by traditional standards. He declares in what surely sounds like a heroic tone that he will die and renounce salvation rather than leave his beloved Sieglinde. Against this, Fricka, the goddess of marriage, argues vehemently, even dogmatically, for the sanctity of the laws of marriage. She decries Wotan's position that adultery is a good thing. And she denies that any, quote, godliness shines forth from the bonding of twins. She tells Wotan they're acting merely on a whim, and that in supporting them, he's throwing overboard what he once valued and ripping apart the bonds that he himself forged. Fricka's arguments persuade Wotan, shaming him into agreeing with her that Sigmund must fall to Hunding in their battle. But inwardly, Wotan is unconvinced, and his acquiescence to Fricka and the traditional laws cost him dearly. And we can see, and clearly Wotan feels, deep conflict about this. For him, the opposition of traditional morality and the heroic, spontaneous morality of the free individual is not one that he can reconcile. Laws are what gave him power and privilege, but now they trap him, even as he longs for pure, heroic freedom of action. In his extraordinary monologue in Act II of Die Walküre, Wotan puts it this way: the bonds now bind me. The rules that made me master have now turned me into their slave. This proves to be his tragic crux. His inability to master this dilemma drives him to woe, anger, regret, and frustration, which will be acted out terribly in the later stages of the opera. Again, very much as Sophie described earlier. Having heard and seen her father's torment, Brunhilde, who loves him despite everything, allows herself to be persuaded by Sigmund to let him triumph against Hunding and thus live on with Sieglinde. She is awed by his declaration of love at any cost, and she feels that in some way this is ultimately Wotan's true wish as well. The decision by Brunhilde has enormous consequences for her, for Wotan, and for Sigmund, as we shall see tomorrow. All of this dramatizes different orientations toward the fundamental conflict between the rules of traditional morality and a new free individual of pure heroism. We see a radically free ego, Sigmund. We see the strict advocate of the rule of law, Fricka, and the most interesting and the most human, Wotan and Brunhilde, each in their own way torn between these two extremes. The emotional and psychological charge all of this carries in Wagner's setting and the performances, as we will hear, is immense. After he had composed Act II of Die Walküre, Wagner wrote, "If this act is presented as I intend, it will most certainly cause an unprecedented wave of strong emotion to break out." While watching and listening, it's entirely possible to feel, and Wagner's music encourages us, perhaps even compels us to do so, that the pursuit of pure love, despite all obstacles, is the highest ideal. We may therefore easily take Fricka for a prig, for moralistic, as someone who's terribly excessively judgy, and Sigmund as an existential hero willing to sacrifice everything for his dream. And maybe this is right, but surely it cannot be so simple. It never is. Can our immediate sympathies mislead us in some ways? Does Wagner's extraordinarily effective music move our sympathies in ways that we can feel but not understand? Should it? Is the idea of a purely reasonable response to such situations a mere delusion? Do not emotions and personal desires always figure even in our most rational moments? A leading goal of this festival, and part of what I think is so exciting about it, is to overcome formulaic points of view and to find in Wagner's operas opportunities for self-reflection and possibly even personal growth. Here, for me, the conflicts and inner tensions and the attempts by both Wotan and Brunhilde to navigate the conflicting demands that confront them are most compelling. They may prove tragically irreconcilable in these dramas, but we can recognize and feel reflections of ourselves in them, and this is both compelling and challenging. Thank you. And I'm certainly glad if there are questions or comments. I think we still have 10 or 15 minutes. I'd be very happy. Yes?
I can understand the apprehension that Mon and others have about the opiate that Wagner's music has and the dangers of pure emotion. what's missing in what Mann was saying is equally the dangers of rationality, unmodified, untempered by human feeling.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems to me what Wagner has done is balance the two and show that there's no real resolution.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I think that's true. I think that's true. And I guess the character who I quoted, who described music as an opiate, in the novel, his counterpart is a character who carries rationality to the points of dangerous extremes and heartlessness. So I think that's true. You know, there's a very interesting quotation or comment about Wagner, I think from W.H. Auden, and he said, for weak characters, Wagner's operas are very dangerous. But for people who are sort of coherent, well-integrated people, they're empowering. And I think that might touch upon what you were alluding to. I don't know if anybody else has a question or a comment.
We have somebody with some experience of Fricka sitting here with us. I don't know if either of those characters would like to comment on anything that Ben said. That would be James and Wayne.
Yeah, and I think it's interesting if you could imagine this, everything being the same, but they're not brother and sister. It would seem very different. And also very relevant to this fact is that Sieglinde was literally, you know, forced more or less at knife point, I suppose, into this marriage. She has she's not in love with her husband, he's not in love with her. It's a pretty horrible situation for her. So in that way, it's very understandable. It's such a conundrum, isn't it? Why is it? And I guess this goes back to some mythical roots. I don't know that this is an incestuous coupling. Yes, Sophie.
Yeah, no, I want to the question of ambivalence.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I wasn't quite sure
No, I don't think so. It's really interesting. I was thinking about this as I was writing this. A couple of years ago, I don't know, 2020, I think, there was a book by Alex Ross that came out about Wagner and Wagnerism. And it was a very fortuitous timing for me because I had been already planning and preparing to teach a course, a seminar on Wagnerism. And one of the things that is so interesting in Ross's book is that, I guess to state the obvious, Wagner has a very fraught reputation, his anti-Semitism, the way in which his music was in some ways, I guess, a fraught question, I guess, complicit with fascism and so forth. But one of the things that Ross does is recuperates a kind of liberatory traditions of reception of Wagner in the early part of the 20th century. And there was a strong feminist movement surrounding Wagner and Wagnerism. There was a strong tradition of queer Wagnerians. And I think in some ways, the way in which transgression is represented and in some ways sort of heroized, or at least, modeled, could be for some people quite freeing and quite, beneficial. Yes?
It strikes me that one of the reasons, or maybe the actual main reason, why incest is such a huge, the biggest taboo, because in a weird way, I don't mean this in an offensive way, but it's the most natural thing. We need to stop it from mm-hmm. happening, and that's why it's so repulsive to us.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And the contrast between that natural attraction and, as you were saying, the law that's imposed upon us so that we can kind of live in the world.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting, right? So Sigmund and Sieglinde are sort of like pure, like some sort of natural human beings in some way. That's interesting. And that's kind of, and I think this is true, that part of what Wotan is seeking is the creation of a free hero who can exist outside of these laws that are trapping him as well as empowering him. It's very interesting. Yes?
While studying the role of Sigmund, one thing that Hugh and I talked about was that Sigmund has his own set of morals, what he believes is correct. He lives by these rules, and those rules are not governed or not the same as the right of regular society.
Mm-hmm.
Love is very big on in his moral compass. So when he sees Sieglinde as in a loveless marriage that she doesn't want to be in, him taking her from that, well, that's not a problem.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing wrong with him removing Sieglinde from that situation. Because, well, they're not in love, so they're not really married, they're not really together.
Mm-hmm.
I am in love with her, we are together. So it's kind of, I like that, the fact that Wotan has all these rules, and he is set on those rules. Sigmund is not. And he creates his own. Mm-hmm. And you can also say, because Wotan raised Sigmund,
mm-hmm.
he kind of raised him in a way that he could not be, that he wouldn't be governed by those same laws.
Yeah. And he never expresses any inner conflict about this. Although Sieglinde does, there's that very terrifying scene when she has the images of the pack of hounds attacking her. Yeah, interesting. So that kind of touches on your point, that he's a kind of pure natural being in some way, unrestricted by some of society's rule. Yeah. Yes, Hugh.
Everything that James just described is acknowledged in explicit language by Hunding about this guest. He says, there's this race, I think I figured out who you are, a young whoever you are without a clear name yet. And I despise that race because you have a distinct moral code. It's completely clear, right? It's completely clear. And that inside the, let's call it the Velisong moral code, at this point, the Velisong is a complete tribe only of two beings. It really, you know, in Zeekman's long narrative that he gives earlier in the act, in front of Sieglinde and Hunding, he describes quite disgusting things, that actions that he has taken, that literally beyond the human pale to be acknowledged as morally justifiable. But for him, as somebody has already just said in the past few minutes, absolutely he has no compunction about them. There is no doubt in his mind. It is I'd like to describe it as an alien moral code. It is full, it is complete, it has an integrity, it has a rigor, it has its exclusions, it has inclusions, it's a perfect system, and it's not our system.
Yeah. It's interesting, and I'm thinking about your comment too, and in a way, Hunding is a character who is completely without emotion, right? I mean, he has, you know, legally he's married to Sieglinde, and that's what counts. And he's not, he has his own moral code, which is completely antagonistic to what you just described, I think, very well of Siegmund.
Essentially, everybody's operating in a gigantic genetic experiment.
Right.
I mean, that's it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Interesting, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, Wotan obviously plans Sieglinde to be there, or he wouldn't have put the sword there.
Mm-hmm.
But he knows where to put the sword, because that's... Eventually, they're going to find each other.
Yeah.
And they're going to find each other right here. So here is where I'm going to place that loop. And at some points... I'm torn a little bit, because I think at some point Sieglinde actually cares in the first act. The sword and Sieglinde are almost the same. Because he talks about both of them in the same light. In the second act, yeah, that he's willing to, I will die for her. But that sword is extremely important to him also.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Absolutely. And both for sort of symbolic reasons, but also for very pragmatic reasons, because he wants to have something to fight and preserve his own life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We are at the hour, more or less, and we have a lovely set of mostly very familiar friends and people here. It is my personal plan to go over to the co-op and grab a bite of lunch over there. I'd love you to be willing to come and join us and sit outside and grab a sandwich if that's what you'd like to do. Please consider accepting that. I'm not buying you lunch. So, do come and join the party. Thank you, Ben.
Thank you. Oh, thank you.